sponsors for Wisconsin Eye's candidate interviews: Wisconsin Hospital Association, Wisconsin Counties Association, League of Wisconsin Municipalities, Five Nines.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Congressman Jim Sensenbrenner.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you all for coming. It's great that on one of his first speeches as our nominee for Vice President, Mike Pence has chosen Waukesha County. Most Republican county in the country. And we're going to keep it that way in November, right? I want to tell you a little bit about the Mike Pence I know. Back in 1988, Mike ran for Congress. And I think I was the only incumbent Republican that went to Indiana to campaign for him. And I found this man to be a dedicated Christian, a family man, and an enthusiastic backer of Reagan conservatives. Now, Mike didn't win that election, and 12 years later, the people of Indiana recognized the mistake and knew that there is a very talented and principled conservative and elected him to Congress. As soon as Mike got to Congress, he became a member of the Judiciary Committee, just as I became the chairman. And Mike was a part of the team helping pass the Patriot Act that made America safer. He was an integral part of passing the partial birth abortion ban bill, which was the first bill that had ever been passed and found constitutional that restricted procedures of abortion since Roe versus Wade. And Mike was right at the bottom of that. He ended up helping me out immensely with the two children's protection bills that were passed that basically was able to allow the FBI to draw a bead on pedophiles and people who molested minors. And I could go on and on and on at Mike's efforts helping me and the rest of the members of the Judiciary Committee make America safer, make our children safer, and to stand up for the right to life. Now, this is the man whom Donald Trump has selected to be his right-hand man after both of them go to the White House. And I can tell all of you without equivocation that the Mike Pence that I've known ever since 1988 has always been on the right side of all the issues. This is a message that we have to get out to people who might have some doubts about whether the conservative agenda will be advanced with this election. They have to go vote. And all of you here have got to make it your main effort between now and November 8th to make sure that everybody who believes in advancing the conservative principles that I've stood for during my entire political career go out and vote for the Trump-Pence ticket. Thank you all. God bless you and God bless America.
My name is Kathy Stepp. I'm the DNR Secretary, and I am very privileged to serve as a cabinet member of the greatest governor in the United States of America, Scott Walker. It is fantastic to see so many faces out here today. I have the unique privilege to be able to join many distinguished guests that are going to be coming out following me, former colleagues of mine in the legislature who are conservative and principled leaders who have taken it upon themselves to take leadership roles and being able to come out and speak about the extreme importance of this very significant moment in our country's time. And for Wisconsin, we are very uniquely poised to be able to show the country full of Republicans about what unity means and why that matters. And I'm speaking right now to all of my fellow female Republicans out here, and this is our time. We are women who care about more than just body parts. We are women who care about national security, who care about public safety, who care about making sure our children have the best educational opportunities and school choice across the country. These are all things that we've been so privileged to have a governor that has led us through so many of these difficult issues and has been unafraid to lead. And now is our turn. Now is our turn to join this ticket, the Trump-Pence ticket, and to make sure that we can demonstrate to the country, to all of the other states who are watching, Wisconsin knows conservative policies and politics. We know how to win elections. We know how to fight the tough fight. And this will be a tough fight unlike what we've ever seen in this country. And we are counting on all of you. So I'm thanking you all in advance, and so many familiar faces that I can see out here in the audience tonight who have been fighting conservative causes, especially in our God-loving Waukesha County, who are just on the front lines of so many campaigns, who have helped me in my career over the years, and who have always been there. Now it means more than ever. Now we'll be calling on that again, and to bring your neighbors, your friends, your cousins, right? Everybody that we can think of needs to get involved, because what's the number one priority is to make sure that Hillary Clinton is not in the Oval Office. In closing, ladies, I just want to make one more appeal to you. We want to be able to demonstrate that we are equal partners in this election process, that what we care about in our households matters in this election, that this is the time more than ever that to really stand up and speak for our families, that we can show that as women, that we care about all the same things that men care about, that we are equal partners in moving this country forward. And I know Wisconsin's going to be placed to do that better than ever. So thank you, Waukesha County. God bless you, and we'll be seeing you out on the campaign trail. It is now my privilege to get to introduce to you one of my former colleagues, a conservative leader in Madison politics, the majority leader of the Wisconsin State Senate, Scott Fitzgerald.
Thank you very much. What a crowd. This is awesome. I'm fired up. All right. So my good friend Tyler August and I were at the convention in Cleveland, and we were sitting around having a couple of grape sodas, and we were talking about creating a slogan that would work for Donald Trump and Mike Pence, okay? So we're gonna start this here, this evening, and after we're done, this is gonna travel across the entire country, okay? So let's practice it first. I'll do the Trump part, you guys do the Pence part, okay? I'll tell you how it's gonna go. Trump, 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 Pence, Pence! Ready? This is the Trump train. This is it. Listen, this is what it sounds like. It's coming down the tracks, right? Trump, 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 Trump.
Pence, Pence.
Trump, 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 Trump.
Pence,
Trump, 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 Trump.
Pence,
there you go. Congratulations. It's going to be on social media in about 5 minutes, probably. Well, I was given the task to talk a little bit about Hillary Clinton. Like Donald says, let's just beat her in November. Let's beat her in November. 68% of Americans think that Hillary Clinton is not trustworthy. Do you agree? Yeah. Everyone knows that she set up a server, both one at her home and at some guy's kitchen in Denver. Do you think that undermined the security of our country? The IRS found that the Clinton Foundation is not only in violation of IRS code, but if they dig a little bit deeper, they'll probably figure out who's been donating and when they've been donating. Once that happens, I think we're going to have another round of investigations on Hillary Clinton. She lied about Benghazi. And we're all well aware of the scandals of the 90s. We're here to support a team that I got to be quite honest with you, I did not see emerging back in January. I never endorsed in the presidential primary, but I had a lot of people in my district in Waukesha County, Dodge, Jefferson, telling me they wanted Donald Trump as the nominee because they wanted to shake up Washington, D.C. And that's why we're here this evening supporting Mike Pence, somebody who I know has not only been a fantastic member of Congress, but a wonderful governor who, as we know as Midwesterners, have a different approach to the way they govern. And that's what Mike Pence is about. That's what Donald Trump saw in Mike Pence. And that's why we're going to have great success in November. So thanks for being here this evening, and we look forward to working with you guys all the way through November. So Trump, 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 Trump. Yes, Trump. Thank you. Thank you. Next, we got Speaker Robin Voss coming out. Robin, come on out.
Hello, Waukesha County. I'm not going to do the Trump thing, but I definitely am on the Trump train. So we are here today not only because the entire future of the nation is on the line, but because we want to show that Wisconsin is a place where conservative values, conservative elected officials, and conservative candidates for president and vice president carry this state in November. Look at where Wisconsin has come. Wisconsin has literally been the epicenter of conservative politics over the course of the past 6 years, and so many people in this room have fought and argued and spoken and worked your hearts out to make sure that people who are elected do what they promise and do what they actually campaign to do when they are running for office the very first time. What we have in Wisconsin right now is a rare chance to make sure that we have candidates who are elected to be president and vice president who are going to shake up the status quo in Washington and give Barack Obama his marching orders right back to Chicago. Eight years ago, when Barack Obama ran for office, we were promised lots of hope and lots of change. Unfortunately, most of us now realize that the change was for the worse in America. Far too many people all across this country still today struggle to find a good-paying job. They struggle to make sure that their kids can save for college. They struggle to make sure that their kids actually move out of the house. We need to have leaders who look at the world that we are in and literally address the problems head-on. Far too long, we have had politicians who have made promises and then never actually worried about delivering once they were elected to office. That is going to change this November. So as most of us in Wisconsin know, we elect people who stand for things. That's why we have the best governor in the entire United States, Scott Walker. We have the most conservative legislature in our entire state's history. And we have what I consider one of our proudest accomplishments, the best speaker of the United States House of Representatives, right here from Wisconsin, Paul Ryan. So many of us have gotten to know Mike Pence and his family over the course of the past several weeks as he was rumored to be chosen, and then last week when we were at the convention when he gave his dynamite speech accepting the vice presidential nomination right there in Cleveland. You know the things that I like about Mike Pence? Number one, he's a committed conservative. This is someone who has been an articulate visionary for making every single conservative idea come to fruition in the state of Indiana. He's somebody who's a committed Christian. He actually respects the fact that God is why we are here. Most of us remember that when Governor Pence was elected in Indiana, he took over a mess. There was a Democrat governor before him, and he had to do a lot of things like we did here in Wisconsin, clean up the mess that was left by the other party. So he definitely understands the fight for individual liberty and personal freedom and making sure that more of the money that you earn stays in your pockets and doesn't get sent off to a faraway capital called Washington, D.C. He had the political courage to lead in Indiana. Most of you probably know that he eliminated Common Core in Indiana. He created new standards that were written by Hoosiers for Hoosiers in the state of Indiana. We know he led the way on school choice expansion because I think most of us realize that in a lot of parts of the country we have great public schools. But there are many parts of the nation where far too many children are being left behind. In Indiana today, over 30,000 children are given a chance to go to a different school that works for their family, not one that's chosen for them by the government. He enacted the largest tax cuts in the state's history. And every single year he was in office, he cut taxes again and again and again. And that's what we need all across our country to revitalize our middle class and spur the economic development that all of us know is there waiting to happen if Washington would just simply get out of the way. Governor Pence is someone who understands that principles are more important than politics. But on occasion, you have to figure out a way to get common ground and bring people together. That's what our nation wants. They want somebody who is articulate, conservative, passionate. But they also want somebody who is going to get things done. So I have no doubt in my mind that as we watch this campaign over the course of the next several weeks, we'll be reminded, like we have been this week, that there is no doubt in my mind that we have all got to focus on one simple thing. Hillary Clinton can never occupy the White House. We know that after watching the DNC this week, they are literally living in a fantasy land. They somehow believe that Hillary Clinton is the savior for our country. I promise you, that is not true. Donald Trump, Mike Pence, men of vision, men who have actually done important things in both the private sector and changing government, those are the people that we need in Washington. Those are the people we need working with Wisconsin's Paul Ryan. And those are the people that if all of us work together, arm in arm, saying that we know America can be great again. We will see a victory in November like we have not seen since my political hero, Ronald Reagan, in 1980. Thank you for being here tonight. Enjoy this time. And go Pence and go Trump.
Welcome the chairman of the Republican National Committee, Wisconsin's own, Reince Priebus.
Hello, Wisconsin! Are you ready to win? Are you ready to win? Well, I gotta tell you, we're feeling really good. We've got the biggest post-convention bounce in 16 years. And how about Donald Trump's speech, right? Did you like it? It wasn't dark. We've got a slow economy. We've got a slow recovery. We have $19.5 trillion in debt. We have an immigration system that's out of control. We have ISIS out of control. And now at the Dem convention, I don't know if you've been tuning in at all, but they've got no talk of ISIS at all. They finally decided to put some flags out on the stage. I don't know if you saw that. And my counterpart, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, I think is on a plane back to Florida. The fact is, Americans have had enough. Americans have had enough of Hillary Clinton's corruption. Americans have had enough of Hillary Clinton's cronyism. Americans have had enough of Hillary Clinton's email scandals. Americans have had enough of her secret server emails sharing our most precious national secrets across the world. Americans have had enough with ISIS. Americans have had enough of all of the garbage and failures, and Donald Trump and Mike Pence are going to put an end to it. We know that Donald Trump and Mike Pence will get our immigration system and our mess under control with dignity and decency. Donald Trump and Mike Pence will get ISIS under control and kill them before they kill us. And Donald Trump and Mike Pence will see to it that we have conservative Supreme Court justices appointed to the court. And Donald Trump and Mike Pence will make sure that we've got a Republican in the White House that can sign a budget that Paul Ryan drafts once and for all. We have an opportunity. God didn't bring us here by accident. Our country and our republic hang in the balance. We know how to do it in Wisconsin. You all have done it time and time again. There is no better operation in getting the job done than in Wisconsin. And we don't have a better governor. Although we've got two great governors tonight, so I have to be careful about this introduction about the greatest governor in Wisconsin in the country. But we have a governor that has faced down all of our opposition over and over again with success. He's done it with courage. He's done it with grit, with integrity, with passion, and most of all, with character. Ladies and gentlemen, our great governor of Wisconsin, the person that we are so proud of, that has led us through all the fights and battles, please welcome the great governor of Wisconsin, Scott Walker.
Good evening, Waukesha. How about that Reince Priebus? You know, last week in Cleveland, they kept asking, Reince grew up to the west of me in Kenosha County. I grew up in Walworth County, and Paul Ryan was to the east of me in Rock County. They kept asking what was in the water back then in south central Wisconsin. I said, it was beer. That's what was in the water. That's what brought all those conservatives. But we're pleased to have a cheesehead in charge, and we're so thrilled to have you all here tonight. You know, I'm excited because Mike Pence is going to be one heck of an outstanding vice president, isn't he? And just in a moment, I'm going to have him and Karen come out and join us. But it is great to see all of you here tonight because many of you remember, in fact, looking at the faces out here, I remember 4 years ago in this very hall, we stood here in 2012 and we celebrated a victory for people across the state and across this country. We celebrated a recall election victory in 2012 right here. And that wasn't a victory about one election or even one night. That was about sending a message that you can take on the big government special interest, take the power out of their hands, and put it into the hands of the hardworking people, and no matter how much they throw against you, no matter how many protesters, no matter how many tens of millions of dollars of attack ads, in the end, if you stand up for the hardworking taxpayers, they will stand up for you. If those conservative reforms can work in a blue state like Wisconsin, they can work anywhere in America. In fact, all of you know, one of the great things was we didn't just win an election, we won for our children and our children's children, for future generations. Today, there are more people employed in this state than there have ever been in our state's history. We're at a 15-year low unemployment. Taxes are down on property and income, on everyone from small business owners and farmers to working families and senior citizens. We see those ACT scores because we invested in our students and gave our school districts the power to run our school districts. ACT scores are now the second best in the country, and our graduation rates were the third best in the country a year ago. And something I know all of you who are parents like I of college-age students, I've still got a senior at the University of Wisconsin, are particularly proud that for the first time ever, we've now frozen tuition 4 years in a row to make college more affordable. All those things showing that conservative reforms work here in Wisconsin, but they work across the country. And someone I got to know long before he was a governor, in fact, I admired Mike Pence from afar. He had a distinguished record. He was one of those Reagan conservatives that served from Indiana in the Congress. And so I always admired him. But brave as he is, outspoken as he is, 5 years ago, you all remember when we were in the thick of the protest here, when they were bringing people in from across the country to occupy our state capitol. That's right, the Occupy movement didn't start in Wall Street. It started on my street over in Madison by the state capitol. But when that was all happening, I remember the folks in Washington who didn't like the idea that maybe people would be willing to stand up against the big government special interest. One of the leaders of that movement, Chuck Schumer, who is a U.S. senator from New York, he got up and he took a shot at some of the House Republicans who were trying to push some of the reforms that we were doing here in Wisconsin. In fact, he actually said that the House leadership, people like Mike Pence and others, were Scott Walker Republicans. And I love this. I believe I got it right. It was a tweet, I believe, if I remember right, Mike told me it was the very first tweet he issued on Twitter was, he tweeted, "I'm proud to be a Scott Walker Republican." So Mike Pence is one of us. He's been one of us even before he became governor. He is a proud, full-spectrum conservative. He is an incredible leader. You know, a couple months after we won here at this expo hall, I had the honor of going to make a couple trips to Indiana because I so admired this man who'd served so well for his country in his congressional district, now was to step up and was willing to be the leader of his state. And I was proud to do that because over the last 3.5 years, he's been one of the most remarkable governors in the country. His state now has incredible employment. In fact, they have the lowest unemployment they've had in a decade and a half. They've made significant investments in their infrastructure and in their schools, not just in public education, but they've now expanded opportunities for choice for families all across their state because, like I do, Mike Pence believes and trusts in parents to make the right decision for their families and specifically for their children. Mike has been a great innovator, not only for the Hoosier state, but a leader across the country. He understands the importance of guaranteeing our constitutional rights all right throughout the spectrum, not just one part of the Constitution or the other, and he particularly understands that not just because of the Constitution, but because of the person who endowed it, that it's important to stand up for the most fundamental life right, the right to life, to ensure life for all those born and unborn. Mike Pence is an incredible, incredible governor. And I hope all of you here will share to others across this state and to others you might know across the country how important this election is. I think one of the best things that Donald Trump has done in this campaign was when he announced that Mike Pence was going to be his running mate. You see, I thought it was great not just because I'm a fellow conservative, not just because I'm a fellow Midwesterner and I appreciate the kind of Boy Scout stand-up integrity that comes with Mike Pence, and he is one of the most honorable people I know in and outside of politics, not just of other elected officials, but he is one of the most honorable people I've ever met in my life. But what I also love about this pick is that Donald Trump was giving us an insight
into how he'll govern. You see, a lot of people say, well, he says these things, but what can he do? I think it is so important. You look ahead to the future. I'm voting on my conscience in this election. My conscience tells me I'm not going to let Hillary Clinton dominate the Supreme Court for the next 20 or 30 years with radical, out-of-control justices. And when I think about those 11 names that Donald Trump listed, people like Diane Sykes, who's from Wisconsin, and others out there who understand that the role of the judiciary is not to make law, but to uphold the Constitution of these United States, no more, no less. If people say to me, how can you trust that Donald Trump will actually pick off of that list? I say, look at his first pick when it comes to governing. He had all sorts of opportunities. What he did was put someone on the ballot to run with him that wasn't just a good political pick. He put someone on the ballot who could govern, someone who will be able to take those ideas of saying, we've had enough with Washington. We've had enough with the out-of-control Washington power players. We think it's time to put the power back in the hands of the American people. And by picking Mike Pence, he picked someone who can actually help him get it done. And so we've got an incredible opportunity, but let's not take it for granted. You know, we had a pretty good convention last week. They're having a less than stellar one this week. Not only is Mike excited, but I think Reince is particularly excited that he wasn't at a convention where they got rid of their chairman on the way into the convention. That's a little bit different contrast out there, right? But think about this. Today of all days, the media completely missed the headline. The headline out there is not what the media is talking about. The headline is, for the first time, you've actually got someone from the Clinton campaign on the record saying that it's no longer a matter of curiosity. The emails are no longer a matter of politics. They are now a matter of national security. Well, it's nice to hear him acknowledging what we've been saying for a long time. They are a matter of national security. Hillary Clinton put our national security at risk by having an unsecured private server in her home. Ladies and gentlemen, that makes her unfit to be the President of the United States. No. There's something better. The best thing to do is to defeat her this November. And the team that's going to do it is Donald Trump and Mike Pence. Ladies and gentlemen, the next Vice President of the United States, my good friend, Governor Mike Pence, and the First Lady of Indiana, Karen Pence.
There she stood. I said, hey, what is this? My baby made it, maybe she's in need of a kiss. I said, hey, what's your name, baby? Maybe we can see things the same. Now don't you wait, oh, hesitate. Let's move before they raise the parking lot.
Hello, Waukesha. Karen and I are so excited to be here with the best governor in the United States of America, Scott Walker. Thank you, my friend. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. Thank you for your mentoring role in my life and for setting such an extraordinary example. I do want to correct you, though. When Chuck Schumer said when I was back in the Congress, when we were fighting against the liberals in the Senate, he said, there's those Scott Walker Republicans over in the House. What I actually tweeted, my very first tweet, when he called me a Scott Walker Republican, I tweeted, Thanks, Senator Schumer. Nobody said anything that nice about me in a long time. I'm a Scott Walker Republican. I appreciate that wonderful introduction. How about a round of applause for our great national chairman, Reince Priebus? What a phenomenal job. I'm so grateful to be here with Speaker Robin Voss, Senate Majority Leader Scott Fitzgerald. This is a great, great state legislature that has put Wisconsin on the map with the leadership of Scott Walker, and I appreciate the folks that are here. And a man, and here's the thing, you may not know this, a man who first campaigned with me when my hair was the same color as Scott Walker's. Back in 1988, a man who's gone on to be a legendary voice for constitutional conservative government, Congressman Jim Sensenbrenner, is my friend and he is my hero. Congressman, thank you. Thank you for being here today. I'm honored to be with all of you. Scott knows, I appreciated that kind introduction and those words, but he knows the introduction I prefer is a little shorter. I'm a Christian, a conservative, and a Republican, in that order. On behalf of my family, let me say we are so honored that you're here. We are so humbled to have been asked to run and serve as Vice President for the next President of the United States of America, Donald Trump. You know, it was just, it seems like, Karen, it was just maybe 2 weeks ago, 11 o'clock at night with my wife at my side, that the phone rang. And I got asked to step into this role. It was a very humbling thing. But I want to say to you that we answered that call in a heartbeat. We answered it in a heartbeat, the call of our country at such a time as this, for three reasons. And I want to share them with you tonight before we have a chance to say hello to as many of you as we can. First and foremost, because after 7.5 years of leadership that has seen America's strength in the world decline and has stifled our nation's economy, I am determined to work with all of you to ensure that Hillary Clinton must never become president of the United States of America. That's number one. Secondly, it's because I know from the experience you've had in Wisconsin with Governor Scott Walker, the experience we've had in the Hoosier State over much of the last 10 years, I know what strong Republican leadership can mean. People that are willing to roll their sleeves up, have government as good as our people, live within your means, make the right investments in education, innovation, and reform, the right investments in roads and bridges, and letting people keep more of their hard-earned tax dollars through tax relief and tax reform, it all still works. And that's the kind of leadership that Donald Trump is going to bring to the White House in Washington, D.C. And lastly, I said yes in a heartbeat, quite simply because having had the opportunity to get to know this good man, I truly do believe that this builder, this patriot, this fighter is going to make America great again when we make Donald Trump the 45th president of the United States. You know, I do believe we're going to win. And I recognize I'm kind of a B-list Republican celebrity, so thank you for coming out tonight. I'm just humbled by this turnout. I truly am. But let me say, we're going to win this election. And we're going to win. We're going to win because we're running on the issues the American people want us to run on. Security, prosperity, and ensuring that the Supreme Court of the United States is peopled by constitutional conservatives who will uphold our rule of law and our finest traditions.
When it comes to the economy, you know, I said the other night, I'm sure Democrats are taking to the podium even at this very hour. They're talking about how good things are. Heard a few excerpts from the president's speech, and he talked about things being so good in America. But I can tell you, down in the Hoosier State and all across this country, they may be telling us that it's the best we can do, but we know better. It's not the best we can do, it's just the best they can do. And with Donald Trump as president of the United States, we're going to get this economy moving and put America back to work. I know that. I know that it works because, as Scott just said and I just shared, we know that when you put common sense conservative principles into practice, it all still works. In the Hoosier State, I've been humbled to be able to serve the state that I love for now almost 4 years. And it's been quite a contrast from a man who will take the stage tonight in the 10 o'clock hour. You know, a lot of people are talking about Hillary Clinton's running mate, Senator Tim Kaine, who will speak to the nation tonight. And let me just say, from my heart, on behalf of my family, whatever the political party, I respect every man and woman who is willing to step forward to serve their country. I really do. But people talk about how we're similar, and, you know, he's the father of three. I'm the father of three, dedicated to his family. He's been a governor. Now he serves in Washington, D.C. I served in Washington, D.C. Now I'm a governor. Is that right? But that's kind of where the similarities end. Whatever you might hear tonight from the stage in Philadelphia, the contrast is pretty dramatic. You know, when Governor Tim Kaine was in office, first thing he did was propose about $4 billion in tax increases on the people of Virginia. I'm proud to say, with the strong support of our General Assembly, we've actually enacted more than $3.5 billion in tax relief for Hoosiers between now and 2022. According to the experts, Tim Kaine took a run at getting some funding for roads and bridges, never quite got that done. As governor of the state of Indiana, we have built on the crossroads of America and invested more than $2.5 billion in roads and bridges at state and local. And when Governor Tim Kaine was governor of Virginia, unemployment almost doubled. And I'm proud to say, over the last 3.5 years, unemployment has dropped from over 8% to 5%, and we have more Hoosiers going to work than ever before in the 200-year history of the state of Indiana. Other than all that, we got a lot in common. It's really a conflict of visions, men and women. I believe it's a conflict also in something more fundamental than the issues, and that's leadership. You know, I was on a television interview tonight, and I said, you know, I think what's been most missing in Washington, D.C. over the last 7.5 years and maybe longer is leadership. And I truly do believe, having spent some time with this good man who will be our next president, is that he is first and foremost a leader who will grab Washington, D.C. by the lapels, and he will shake the results out that will unleash the full potential of the American people. That's what leadership does. You know, the choice could not be more clear. American people could elect someone who literally personifies the failed establishment in Washington, D.C. Or we can choose a leader who will fight every day to make America great again. It is change versus the status quo. And I am telling you right now, here in Waukesha, when Donald Trump becomes president of the United States, the change will be huge. It really is amazing. I said it last week. At a time when the American people are crying out for something different, crying out for a new brand of leadership, the other party has come up with someone the most predictable of names and the most stale agenda. More government, more taxes, more regulation.
and somebody who actually thinks Obamacare is just a good start. Well, I can tell you, lastly, the reason why I said yes to Donald Trump in a heartbeat is because Donald Trump gets it. He's a genuine article. He has a vision for this country that I believe will turn America around. Now, I believe he's someone who will put the safety and security of the American people at home and abroad first and foremost for the people of this country. Donald Trump, in these troubled times, in too many American communities, Donald Trump will support our law enforcement at every level, make sure they have the resources to do their job and go home safe. And abroad, it'll be just the same. After years of seeing our military hollowed out, years of seeing our adversaries and our competitors emboldened all across the world, Donald Trump will rebuild the American military. He will marshal the resources of this country. He will hunt down and destroy the enemies of our freedom. At a time when we've seen our laws disregarded, our borders go unrespected, this man will uphold the rule of law and ensure secure borders in the United States of America. And lastly, it's so important that we reflect on this simple fact, that while we're choosing a president for the next 4 years, the next president of the United States will likely make decisions regarding the Supreme Court of the United States that will span the next 40 years. And I would submit to you tonight, for the sake of our Constitution, for the sake of the sanctity of life, for the sake of our Second Amendment and all our God-given liberties, we must make sure that the next president making appointments to the Supreme Court of the United States is Donald Trump. Hillary Clinton's record on the world stage must also be remembered and considered. It's extraordinary to think, in this time of terrorist attacks at home and abroad and inspired here at home, grim and heartbreaking scenes, a Catholic priest murdered in his own church at the hands of ISIS terrorists. Attempted coup in Turkey, all attest to a world spinning apart. You know, history teaches us that weakness arouses evil. And I believe that Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama's foreign policy of leading from behind, moving red lines, feigning resets with Russia, and the rise, rule, and reign of ISIS are a testament to this truth of history. We cannot have 4 more years apologizing to our enemies and abandoning our friends. America needs to be strong for the world to be safe, and Donald Trump will lead on the world stage with American strength. And let me say one other matter. Having spoken with this good man, he's someone who cherishes freedom. And not just economic freedom. You know, the freedom of speech and the freedom of religion have been at the heart of the American experiment since our nation's founding. Independence rang as much from the pulpits of this country at our nation's founding as it did from the town squares. The truth is that slavery would be brought down in large part because of the moral voice of men and women of faith who demanded a more just society. The civil rights movement and the great progress we've made toward equality in this country was forged in the pews of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King's church in Montgomery, that all, at very few exceptions, great social change in America has been driven by people of faith. And yet, since 1954, there's been a law on the books that Senator Lyndon Johnson enacted, the Johnson Amendment, that actually prohibits tax-exempt organizations, institutions of faith, from advocating or supporting or opposing a candidate for office. I'll never forget the first time I ran for office 16 years ago successfully. I was scheduled to share my testimony of faith at my home church. And my pastor actually said, after I'd announced for Congress, that we better not do that because I was a candidate for office. Well, I'll tell you a story that I heard. It happened about 6 months ago. It was in a small meeting that Donald Trump had with pastors and religious leaders from around the country. And the subject of support came up, and they said, well, we're supporting you. We appreciate your strong stand for the sanctity of life. We appreciate your strong stand for the Constitution, but we can't because of this law. And Donald Trump said, we need to change the law. And I want to commend Reince Priebus because repealing the Johnson Amendment is in the Republican Party platform that was just adopted at the Republican National Convention. But it really all began with Donald Trump. It all began in a conversation. You know, politicians always ask what. Leaders ask why. And Donald Trump did just that in that moment, and I want to promise you, we drive forward, we bring about a victory for the American people. Donald Trump will repeal the Johnson Amendment and restore the freedom of speech and the freedom of religion of people of faith all across this country. And that's always been the hope of America, hasn't it, man? I grabbed a quote out of the book Democracy in America. Scott Walker and I are great students of history. It's one of the things that bonded our friendship early on. Alexis de Tocqueville did a study of America just after our founding. He was fascinated by this great, brave country that emerged in this wilderness. And he wrote these words so many years ago, and I believe they're still true today. And they bespeak the importance of the change that I just described to you, and the importance of all of us appealing to something far beyond politics to see us through these troubled times. De Tocqueville wrote, "I sought for the key to the greatness and genius of America in her harbors, in her fertile fields and boundless forests, in her rich mines, her vast world commerce, in her public school system and institutions of learning. I sought for it in her Democratic Congress and in her matchless Constitution. But not until I went into the churches of America and heard her pulpits flame with righteousness did I understand the secret of her genius and power. America is great," he wrote, "because America is good. And if America ever ceases to be good, America will cease to be great." Timeless wisdom, centuries ago, looked on. We can make America great again. We can make America great again by electing leadership that sees the boundless potential of the American people, that understands America's obligations and place in the world as a beacon of freedom and the arsenal of democracy. We can make America great again if we ensure that our courts are peopled by individuals who respect our Constitution and our God-given liberties. But make no mistake about it, men and women, we can make America great again if we will remember that we are and always have been one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. So, people of Wisconsin, all my new best friends in Waukesha. Here in this historic arena where so much of the history of your great governor has been made and will be made again. I believe we've come to another rendezvous with destiny. And I have faith. I have faith in the boundless capacity of the American people to meet that rendezvous with courage and vision. And I have faith that God is not finished with America yet. But we have a choice to make. If you want a president who will protect this nation, confront radical Islamic terrorism, and rid the world of ISIS, if you want a president who will restore law and order to this country and give law enforcement the support that they deserve, if you want a president who will cut taxes, grow our economy, squeeze every nickel out of the federal bureaucracy, and repeal Obamacare, lock, stock, and barrel, if you want a president who will build strong borders and enforce our laws, if you want a president who will upend the status quo in Washington, D.C., and appoint justices who will uphold our Constitution, we have one choice, and that man is ready. This team is ready. Our party is ready, and we must elect Donald Trump as the 45th president of the United States of America. Let's get to work.
At her feet was a footloose man.